Hello and welcome back, everyone. I hope you guys are all still happy and healthy and safe. And I hope by now you've gotten a strong understanding of ecology, evolution, and biodiversity. So, now with those topics covered, we're going to actually start diving into the individual organisms and types of organisms that make up biodiversity. And we're going to begin with my personal favorite topic, the microbes. This presentation will have two parts. The first half and the second half will be delineated with a middle slide that goes to the middle. The first half will cover microbes in general and then primarily focuses on bacteria, prokaryotes. And then the second half will cover viruses, archaea, protists, and prions. So, what I recommend is going through the first half of this presentation, kind of learning that material, being familiar with that material, and then moving on to the second half of this presentation. So we're going to begin by defining microbes. What are microbes? So this term is actually quite broad, and it really encompasses any organism that's small or microscopic. And that's problematic because it encompasses bacteria, virus, protists, and archaea, which are not even remotely related to one another. And in the case of viruses, they're not even considered living at all. So this term is a very, very broad term that essentially, when you hear it, just means something that's microscopic and small. There are microbes present in all three domains of life. There are some in eukarya, archaea, and bacteria, or prokaryotes, as you'll see me use that word interchangeably with bacteria. And then, like I mentioned, we have our viruses, and the viruses are not even considered living, but we'll talk a lot about them later on in part two of this presentation. Microbes are genetically and metabolically diverse, arguably the most diverse category of life slash non-life on this planet. There are millions of species that have not even yet been identified. And we know that they're out there due to genetic analyses, and we'll find RNA and DNA from various species, but we've never been able to see them in many cases. And we'll talk about why that is a little bit later. Microbes are ubiquitous. They cover every surface and are in every habitat on this earth. That includes the depths of the Marianas Trench, where you imagine nothing could survive because of the intense heat and pressure and lack of light. Those conditions are really, really hostile, but there are organisms that survive and thrive in those environments. Same thing with the ice caps, where it's super duper cold, and brine pools, where the environment is really salty, and generally that will dry out cells. But in this case, they survive, they thrive, they need that environment. Same thing with your intestines, your microbiome, which has become we've gone and learned a lot about in the last couple years. There's tons of animals, I mean, tons of organisms that live inside of you and on you. Actually, you're more them than you. You're more not you than you if you really go by numbers of cells. And then also, like in hot springs, like we talked about, hot environments where you would imagine nothing can live. These organisms of various types are just thriving. They're far more hardy than we are. Like I mentioned, the human intestine has a lot of microbes. Your body in general has a lot of microbes. There are 90 trillion microbes on you alone. Okay, so you can imagine if there's 90 trillion on humans, compare that to how big the world is, right? And microbes cover every surface that you can think of. So there's a lot of microbes. So the first half of this presentation will focus on bacteria, prokaryotes exclusively. So we're first going to just review a little bit of the structure of bacteria. This is mo should be mostly a refresher from 1103. If you can't remember this material, I would go back to the first half of your textbook and review the general structure of bacteria. But there are some core details of bacteria. They're generally more simple than eukaryotes. And there's a lot of diversity out there, but the general structure is that they have a cell wall, which is highlighted here as this green layer. And then below their cell wall, they have a plasma membrane, which is also a little challenging to see in this image here, but their plasma membrane is right here in this image, okay? And then they have the cytoplasm. So when you're looking at the order from outside in, you have your cell wall, your plasma membrane, then your cytoplasm. Within the cytoplasm, they have a singular large circular chromosome. This is the genome of the organism. Some bacteria have more than one chromosome, but generally there's one circular chromosome. And then also within the cytoplasm, we'll have the smaller circular genetic material, which I'm highlighting here, and like this one here, which are termed as plasmids. And these are extra chromosomal pieces of DNA that generally code for a variety of different functions, proteins and things like that. And we'll talk a little bit more about plasmids in a minute. There are also plenty of proteins and enzymes that kind of float around inside of the cytoplasm, and they're responsible for performing all the different functions of the cell, and including especially transcription, so we can get the proteins that we need. And with that being said, there are no organelles, there is no nucleus in bacteria or prokaryotes for the most sense. And so these proteins and enzymes that are within the cytoplasm and that are within the plasma membrane and even on the cell wall, they're responsible for performing all the functions that the cell needs. So in a eukaryotic cell, the organelles are usually responsible for their various different functions that they're responsible for undertaking. However, in a prokaryotic cell, just the plasma membrane and all the proteins that are involved with keeping the cell functioning are responsible for everything. Additional features that some bacteria may have, but not all, are the presence of a flagella, which helps with movement, locomotion, a capsule. And so in this image here, this brown substance, like that's out here, is supposed to represent a capsule. And it's essentially a polysaccharide layer that lies on the outside of the cell wall. And it basically protects the cells from drying out and actually also helps them stick to surfaces. So when we're talking about an organism attaching to a surface or forming biofilms, and if you wanna know more about biofilms, please contact me. That was my dissertation work. That this capsule can play a major role in that. Also, pili. Pili are these little, in this image, these little stringy bits here that are coming out. That also helps with attachment to surfaces and with locomotion. And then you can have some organisms that form spores. So one example of this is Bacillus anthracis, or what people know it for as anthrax. They will form these internal spores within their cytoplasm that make them extremely resilient. They're very, very hard to get rid of once a bacteria has gone into a spore form. So as I mentioned, there's a lot of diversity out there in bacteria, and we're going to spend some time talking about the different characteristics that bacteria can have. And these are also characteristics that are used by microbiologists to identify and classify bacteria into various groups. One of the first characteristics we're going to talk about is their shape. So we have three basic shapes that bacteria generally come in. The first we're going to talk about are cocci. And so if you look at this image here, a cocci in this first image are these little purple balls here. And essentially a bacteria that's a cocci is like a ball. So you can just imagine that. In this case, this image is actually of Staph aureus, and they cluster together into what we call a grape-like formation, but each of these individual spheres is a cell. The second type of shape we have are bacilli. So bacillus form these rod shapes. Let's use a different color. These rod shapes. And actually, this is two different cells. That's a cell, and this is a cell. Same thing here. This is one cell, and this is two cell. And if you look at these cells, you can tell they're more elongated in shape. They look more like rods. This image is actually Bacillus anthracis, the bacteria that causes anthrax. And then the third type of shape we have are those that are in a spiral shape. So this last image here is a picture of Treponema pallidinum, which is the bacteria that causes syphilis. And you can see they're in these nice little coils. You don't want to get this, but they're in these nice little coil formations, and this actually helps them to burrow into your tissues as well. So these are our three shape types: cocci, bacilli, and spiral. They also have variety in cell wall structure. So we have two categories of microorganisms, generally gram-positives and gram-negatives. An example of a gram-positive is Staph aureus or Streptococcus mutans. An example of gram-negative would be like E. coli or Pseudomonas aeruginosa. And the difference between these two organisms is how their cell wall is structured. In these images, the purple bits here is the peptidoglycan layer. Okay, in a gram-negative organism, they have their plasma membrane. So going from inside out, they have their cytoplasm, plasma membrane, a peptidoglycan layer, and then more membrane. Okay, so it's almost like a sandwich. Membrane, peptidoglycan layer, another membrane. And this is what we can term as a gram-negative organism. And that middle peptidoglycan layer is generally pretty thin. And I think you guys probably talked about peptidoglycan and things like that in your 1103 class. If you haven't, I will go ahead and look that up. But when we're looking at gram-positive organisms, they have a thick peptidoglycan layer that's right outside the plasma membrane. So instead of that sandwich formation, they go from cytoplasm, plasma membrane, and then they have their peptidoglycan layer. And so these differences in structure actually have an effect when you try to stain them. We use a stain in microbiology called crystal violet, and this dye essentially will get into the plasma, get into the cell wall, and will bind there. And I think that's why they also made it purple in this image, and it'll stain it purple. It gets trapped in that peptidoglycan layer and turns purple. In the case of gram positives, when you try to wash that stain away, they remain purple because that dye is still stuck in the peptidoglycan layer in the cell wall. However, when you have gram negatives, when you go to wash away that stain, most of it disappears. Actually, almost all of it disappears. And then you can actually counter stain them with another dye. And so when we're doing something, this is called gram staining. When you're doing a gram stain, if you have a gram positive organism, they will be purple. They will stay purple. If you wash them, they'll remain purple. If you have a gram negative organism, they will look pink due to the counter stain. And this is how people, scientists, microbiologists can differentiate. If you have an unknown sample, you usually, one of the first tests you do is to see if it's a gram positive or a gram negative by doing a gram stain. If it's purple, it's gram positive. If it's pink, it's gram negative. There's also different mechanisms by which the organisms will get their energy. I have included a table here. You do not need to know this table in super depth, but I wanted to include it so that you can understand where some of these names come from. So if you get your energy source from the sun, you're considered a phototroph. If you get it from other chemical compounds, breaking down chemical compounds, you're called a chemotroph. If you get your electrons in the electron transport chain, from organic substances, you're an organotroph. If you get it from inorganic substances like hydrogen sulfide or something like that, you're called a lithotroph, which is anything organic has carbon, so organotroph. If it's not a carbon-containing molecule, it's a lithotroph, okay? And then if you have, you get your carbon from the consumption of other organisms, you're considered a heterotroph. But if you get carbon because you make it yourself, you're considered an autotroph. So these different terms can actually be combined in different ways to specifically let you know how an organism gets its energy and how it undergoes certain metabolism. The three that are most important that I want you guys to remember are chemoorganotrophs, and essentially they eat carbon, right? So they need to eat something else in order to survive. So this is, like you can imagine, humans are chemoorganotrophs, right? We have to eat something else in order to survive, something else that's living to survive. Then you have your chemolithotrophs, or you can say they eat rocks. They survive off of inorganic substances, so substances that do not contain carbon, to survive. And then you have your photoautotrophs, which eat light. So these are organisms that will make their own food through photosynthesis from light. There are also variations in air tolerance. So believe it or not everything on Earth needs air to survive. In some cases, oxygen can be toxic. So we have various tolerances of oxygen. We have our aerobes, and in this image, they have it as obligate aerobes, where you need oxygen to survive. If we were a bacteria, if we were a species of bacteria, we would be obligate aerobes, right? We need air to survive. Then you have your anaerobes, and in this image, they have it as, I'm just gonna indicate it here, as obligate anaerobes, which do not need air to survive. And it actually, in this case, if you're an obligate anaerobe, if you are exposed to oxygen, you will die. So you have to be in an anaerobic condition. These are very common at the bottom of the ocean, in the soils at the bottom of lakes, where oxygen is very, very low, or not at all, right? It needs to be extremely low. But if you turn over, let's say, the soil at the bottom of a lake, you actually might be killing off a lot of the bacteria that live down there because now they're being exposed to oxygen, right? You have facultative anaerobes, which is this image here. Facultative anaerobes, they can live in anaerobic environments, but they prefer to have oxygen. So as you can see in this image here, most of the cells are located at the top of the test tube, but they also can live at the bottom of the test tube too. And this usually tells microbiologists that there are certain pathways that this organism has that allows it to switch between using oxygen to not using oxygen. And then another one we'll talk about are organisms that are microaerophilic. And these are bacteria that only want a little bit of oxygen, right? If you get too much, they'll die. If they don't have any at all, they'll die. They need just a very specific amount of oxygen to survive. And then the aerotolerance, they just don't care. You give them oxygen, they're great. If you don't give them oxygen, they're great. They just don't care. And then one major way that microbiologists, that we go about identifying organisms if they're unknown, is through their colony formation. So bacteria alone are small, right? They live alone. But generally in nature, bacteria actually don't live alone. And especially when they replicate, they form these colonies. So if you have one cell, they divide to two cells, divide to four cells, divide to eight cells, right? You can see how this is getting more and more and more cells, and they're actually start to go from being invisible as one cell to visible as a colony. And every organism has a distinct colony formation. So you can have smooth colonies. An example of that would be like this yellow colony here. Let me use a different color. This yellow colony here is a smooth colony. It's kind of like what I would see when I was working with Staph aureus in the lab. You can have rough colonies, which would be something like this. Bacillus subtilis makes rough colonies. This is also a very rough colony. It just looks rough on the surface. You have mucoid colonies. These ones look gross and sticky. This yellow and orange one also are kind of mucoid in nature. They look like they're slimy, right? And then differences in coloration. And you can see from this image, all these different colonies have different colors because these different organisms, through their metabolism, will produce different colors. Also, the cells themselves may have pigment. And then this may seem a little gross, but you can actually sometimes smell the difference between colonies. When I was a grad student, I had a plate and I wasn't quite sure what was on my plate. I thought it was E. coli, but I wasn't sure. And so I would smell it. And to me, E. coli smells like cardboard boxes. Like nasty cardboard boxes, but cardboard boxes nonetheless. And I gave it to my professor, and the first thing he did is he looked at it. He said, they're kind of white. They're kind of mucoidy. Looks like a E. coli. And then he smelled it and was like, yep, E. coli, because it gives off a specific smell. Some of the worst smelling things that I've had to work with in lab are Bacillus. Bacillus subtilis smells really bad. But some things don't smell at all. Sometimes you're lucky and you're working with something that doesn't give off a smell, but that is one way that you can kind of tell based on the colonies. So bacterial growth. Bacterial growth is logistic in nature, which we talked about in our ecology lecture, where we have our distinct phases. Our lag phase, just as a reminder, is when we're getting slow levels of growth, but there is some growth. And then we have our exponential phase, or our log phase, where there's a huge spike in growth, where a number of cells is increasing exponentially. And then we have our stationary phase, which is when the carrying capacity of the environment is being met, right? And so the amount of resources and the density, the mineral resources is vastly decreased. So there's lots of competition. There's minimal resources, minimal space. So the carrying capacity, as a reminder, is the maximum density of an organism that can be supported by that environment. So that's when we reach our stationary phase. And then in this graph, you'll actually see a death phase. In bacteria, if you have a culture tube, it's not like they stay in stationary phase forever. Eventually, all of the nutrients will be gone. There's no more growth. Like, even in stationary phase, you're getting some growth, but it, like, you're getting some replication, but it's at very, very, very low levels. And that's how you keep maintaining the same density of cells. But in the death phase is when there's no more nutrients at all. There's no more space, no more food, no more nothing. And then they'll start to die off. And so we actually have this death phase if you keep going with this graph. This curve actually varies for each organism. So some organisms grow very, very fast, and some bacteria grow very, very slow. So let's say this curve here is E. coli. E. coli is notorious for growing very fast. It's time to reach exponential phase, to start going into this exponential phase, is about the replication time is 20 minutes. So it replicates every 20 minutes, which is very, very fast. So we'll go from our lag phase to our exponential phase to stationary phase relatively quickly. Within the course of a 9-hour day, like a 9-hour work day, you can actually go from having a very, very low concentration of cells to exponential phase to stationary phase for these. Some cells do not grow that fast. They require hours just to replicate. So it takes hours for one cell to go to two cells, from two cells to go to four cells. And that type of growth curve would actually look something more like this. It'll look like nothing's happening for a long time. Let's say this is hours, and then we'll start to see something that does like this. So it takes them longer to replicate. So it takes them longer to start seeing their exponential phase. This could be, you don't see exponential phase for days. This is especially prevalent when you have anaerobic bacteria because they generally grow slower. So keep that in mind. There's a lot of variability out there. So we're going to switch gears now from talking about general diversity that we see in prokaryotes to talking about their genetic material and more specific details about prokaryotes. So as I mentioned before, bacteria contain one singular large chromosome, circular chromosome, and this is their entire genome. They will also have these small circular pieces of genome, pieces of DNA that exist outside of their genome, which is usually referred to as a plasmid or extra chromosomal DNA. Bacteria have to be exceptionally efficient because they don't really live that long. So they are actually able to undergo simultaneous transcription and translation. So if you can remember in eukaryotes, you have your DNA is transcribed to our mRNA, and then that mRNA has to travel outside the nucleus to meet with a ribosome to be translated into a protein. In prokaryotes, they can do all of that at once. So the RNA polymerase, which we'll show here, the RNA polymerase will bind to DNA and start transcription. And as the mRNA strand, which is here, is being produced, ribosomes that are present within the cytoplasm will begin to attach, and they will start translating that mRNA into proteins. And you can actually have in this image, as it shows you, generally you will have multiple ribosomes that will bind to that mRNA strand. So you can imagine this is time efficient and energy efficient. If you have more than one ribosome binding to this template, making plenty of proteins at the same time it's being transcribed, you're able to make rapid changes in yourself that could mean the difference between survival and death. This also occurs on plasmids as well. This process of co-transcription translation is not exclusive to the genome. genes on the chromosome are organized into what we call operons. They're also generally in operons on plasmids as well. And an operon is a unit of a set of genes that are all structurally related to one another. So this makes it very efficient because, let's say in this image, our genes here are A, B, C, and D, right? A, B, C, and D, let's say, are all pieces that are involved with, making a pump in the plasma membrane of the cell. And this protein has four parts. Instead of making one mRNA to one protein for A, and then making another mRNA for protein for B, C, and D, instead of doing that, which you can imagine takes some time, what bacteria will do is they'll put all of those genes together in one long piece. And so that when RNA polymerase binds, which will bind here at the promoter, and if this is not familiar to you, that's fine. You'll talk more about this later. I'm not going to hound you on where a RNA polymerase binds or anything like that, but RNA polymerase will bind to your promoter, and it will start to transcribe this. It'll go and start to transcribe these genes A, B, C, and D into one mRNA strand, and then that mRNA strand, as we talked about, is translated as it's being transcribed, right? So then the ribosomes will bind to that transcript and it'll start to produce proteins A, B, C, and D independently. And if you're interested on how that process occurs, I recommend taking a molecular biology class or advanced molecular biology. It's very interesting how you can take one mRNA strand and end up with four different proteins from it. But essentially, the take-home message is that they organize related genes in sequence with one another. So if you're making one mRNA strand, you can make 4, 5, 6, 10 proteins from that single mRNA strand. It's very, very efficient. Also, this another addition to being efficient is the lack of introns. So in humans, we have mRNA that must be removed from the transcript before it's made into a protein. We don't have that in prokaryotes. Everything that's transcribed is then translated. There's also no 5' cap, no poly A tail. You don't need any of that stuff. Just transcribe, translate, and move on. As mentioned before, we have plasmids. Plasmids play a major role in the evolution of organisms. They can be metabolic plasmids, so they can have contain genes for proteins that will allow a bacteria to consume something that they couldn't before. And so this is one way we can end up with that diversity of organisms that can live off of hydrogen sulfide or methane that we just don't see in bacteria that normally would, you know, live on your food or something like that. You can also have resistance plasmids. So these are really important, and we'll talk a little bit later in this presentation about antibiotic resistance, but these play a major role in some of the issues that we're having with antibiotic resistance today. And then you have virulence plasmids, which code for proteins that help the organism grow, but really they're harmful to us. So This is not because they hate us, they want to get us or anything like that. It's just there are certain proteins that will be helpful for the bacteria to survive, but when our immune system sees those proteins, it goes crazy. And so this is kind of how you can get like toxic shock syndrome and things like that from our immune system just seeing those proteins and just overreacting. So, bacteria have a couple different ways of transferring their genetic material. We have the most known way is vertical gene transfer. This is transfer of genetic material from the parent to the offspring. And so in this image, it shows you that you start with one cell, which is, this is our parent cell. And that parent cell will have to replicate its genetic information. So if you can see here, there's two copies of each of these plasmids, and there's also two copies of the genome. So when a bacteria replicates, it replicates all of its genetic material, including the plasmids, and then it'll start to split and then each of the resulting daughter cells. Sorry, guys, for my poor handwriting. It's hard to write on something that's sitting vertically. But the two resulting daughter cells or offspring will have the same genetic material as the parent. This is through binary fission, and it's also referred to commonly as cloning, because these two cells are genetically the same as their parent cell. You can also have horizontal gene transfer, and this is the transfer of genetic material between two organisms that's not via cell division. So we have conjugation, which is when two bacteria that are either related or they can even be unrelated will be in close proximity with one another, and then one will build something we call a pili, which acts as a bridge between those two cells, and it will transfer genetic material from one cell, which is the donor cell, to the recipient cell. So in this case, this cell here, this cell is our donor cell. And let's say it's a Staph aureus cell. And that Staph aureus cell is just hanging out in the environment, and it comes in close proximity to this strep mutans cell. Okay, and that Staph aureus cell has a plasmid, and let's say that plasmid codes for resistance to ampicillin. It can form a pilus, and which will basically act as a bridge into that that streptococcus cell, that recipient cell, and then it will push the genetic material from itself into the recipient cell. So now, when those two cells separate, they both have antibiotic resistance now. So this is one way. I'm using antibiotic resistance as an example, but it could be various genes that are transferred from one cell to another via conjugation. You also have transduction, and this is when there are viruses out there that infect bacteria, and those viruses, if they are infecting a bacteria, when they leave from that bacteria, sometimes they take up not necessarily their own genome, but they take up genome from the host. And we'll talk a little bit more about viruses and all this type of process a little later. If this is a little confusing, just hold on for a minute. But when the virus is leaving the cell, sometimes instead of grabbing its own genetic material, it will grab the genetic material of the host. In this case, is a bacteria. And then when it goes to another bacteria, it will actually drop off that genetic material from the first bacteria. So from the first host to the second host, and that's how the genetic material is transferred between two different bacteria. Then we have transformation, and transformation is when you have a cell, a bacterial cell, we refer to these cells as competent cells. And that means that they can just basically pick up genetic material from the environment. So there's DNA everywhere, all over the environment. Anytime a bacterial cell dies, its DNA basically just gets put out in the environment. And if you imagine, if there's a cell, a host or initial cell that dies, its DNA is just sitting there. It's just in the environment. And another cell comes along, and there's that DNA that's there, and that cell is competent, it can then just take up that DNA and it will incorporate it into itself. So now it has whatever characteristics, some of those characteristics that were left behind from the cell that died. All three of these mechanisms are ways of genetic transfer between two organisms that's not from parent to offspring. So bacteria, we generally think about them as the bad guy, but really, they're not always so bad. Most bacteria out there are actually benign to us. They have no benefit or drawback or harmful effect directly on us. So there might be some indirect effects because they play a major role in the ecosystem as food and as recyclers of nutrients, but there might not be a direct harm or benefit for us. But there are some that are beneficial. So in industrial microbiology, these beneficial bacteria are exceptionally important. They're used in the food industry. This image here is actually a person holding a jar of kombucha. I personally love kombucha, But you can also use it if you're not a kombucha person, in yogurt, cheese production, all of that type of stuff. We use beneficial bacteria to help us make the food that we eat. Also, probiotics. I know many people who take probiotics. It's very, very important. That's actually why I drink kombucha. It's probiotic. But that can also make a big impact on your health if you take probiotics. So that's beneficial. That's good. Basically, it's good gut bacteria. So you take a pill or you drink something, and it has these bacteria that are generally good for you or benign for you, and they will help to line your gut digestive tract, and that will basically outcompete the bacteria that can cause you harm, and that can prevent you from getting sick or help with illness. You also have cases of bioremediation. So I know many people remember the BP oil spill out there in the Gulf of Mexico. Bacteria are a major player in clearing up the environment. So if you didn't know, that's still out there, but bacteria have really played a major role in eating up that oil and putting it back as helpful nutrients in the environment. We also use them for making drugs and vitamins, and also in energy production. I know that's a big field that people are starting to look into, is how can we harvest energy from bacteria? Also, can we recycle plastics using bacteria? We talked about the Pacific gyre and other pollution out there. People are trying to figure out ways of getting rid of plastic pollution using bacteria. And then also there's beneficial bacteria, as I mentioned, in your gut as your microbiome, but also on your skin. There's a whole like world living on you and in you. And they protect you for the most part from most pathogens. So they play a major important role in your health. There's also harmful bacteria. So this is a very, very small population of the bacteria that are out there are actually harmful. And when they are harmful, we call them pathogens. And so some examples that you might be familiar with are cholera, typhoid, the plague, like the Black Death, gonorrhea, syphilis, chlamydia, etc. This image here is actually of a man. It's a very famous picture of a man with advanced stage syphilis. So if you didn't know, if syphilis goes untreated, you first see the symptoms when you contract it via sexually transmission, unprotected sex. And then that at first you notice it in your genitals, it's a problem, but then it'll go away. Right, so you think that it's gone, you think it's healed itself, but in actuality, what it's done is it's gone dormant. And in the olden days, in the 1800s, 1700s, even way before that, what would happen is people would get these lesions on their face, because what syphilis will start to do is it will travel up your nerves to your face and to your brain, and it starts eating away at your brain and eating away at your face. So people would get these lesions on their face, and eventually they might even lose their nose due to advanced stages of syphilis. So before the advent of antibiotics, it wasn't uncommon to see people with these scars and marks all over them. And mentioning antibiotics, if we don't keep finding new ways of combating syphilis, these types of symptoms actually might come up again. And then also sometimes your microflora can be a bad guy. So most of the time your microbiome, your normal flora, all the bacteria that are living on you are the good guys. But if there are certain circumstances occur, like if you are immunocompromised or if they get out of hand, they just grow out of crazy. It can actually cause disease. So you can have necrotizing fasciitis, which some of you guys might know is flesh-eating disease. That's actually caused by a bacteria that normally lives on your body, and it's normally fine, but under very specific conditions, it gets out of hand and it'll start to eat away at your tissues. You can also have strep throat. Many of us have had strep throat. I know I was had this a lot as in middle school. That's also a normal bacteria. That's actually the same bacteria that causes necrotizing fasciitis. It's called strep pyogenes. It lives in your throat and it's normally okay, but sometimes, let's say you're under a lot of stress and your immune system is down, or something happens and it flares up, you can get strep throat. You can also get boils on your skin. Many people have had boils, especially as a child. This is due to Staph aureus. Staph aureus is very common. It's actually in one third of people's nasal cavity. It's the main organism I worked with in my dissertation work, so I'm very familiar with it, but it can cause boils and it can cause serious issues as well. Okay, so now we're going to talk about the topic that I've been alluding to this whole time, which is antimicrobial resistance. So first, a little history on antibiotics. Antibiotics are not as old as you might think. They were actually discovered in 1921. And essentially what happened was a scientist called Alexander Fleming, a microbiologist, he had a petri dish of bacterial cells and he left them out and he went on vacation. And then when he came back, he noticed that there was a fungus growing on that petri dish, but there was a clearance area around the fungus where there were no bacteria, where there should have been. And so that led him to wonder what happened here, and that led to the discovery of actually penicillin. That fungus that was on his plate was a penicillium fungus, and the drug that, or the compound that it was putting out to kill those bacteria, we now call penicillin. And penicillin was available first on the market in 1928, and it majorly changed the game for human life, human life expectancy and quality of life. Well, antibiotics are actually not for us specifically, if you will. The fungus did not make penicillin to help us. They actually made it as a form of competition and defense. So, and most antibiotics actually come from living organisms, from plants, other bacteria, or fungi, and they're a way of defending themselves, especially in the case of plants and like fungi, from bacterial infection, and also can be used as competition. So you can imagine if you're if you have two species of bacteria and they're competing for the same space, and bacteria A can actually produce a compound that when it interacts with species B, it will kill species B. So you can imagine that's beneficial because that allows species A to get an advantage, an upper hand over species B and take over that area, right? And get all the resources and outcompete species B. So that's how antimicrobial compounds actually originated, as a result of competition and as a way of defending or for organisms to defend themselves against bacteria. So like I mentioned, antibiotics are actually not that old in their discovery. It's only been approximately 80 years. And in the last 80 years, we've actually seen a lot of resistance towards antimicrobial agents. So since 1921, we've discovered so many antimicrobial compounds, but we're starting to see in some of our most effective compounds, bacteria are resistant, which means they're no longer effective. They're like, oh, you're gonna treat me with ampicillin? That's fine. And they just keep going, right? So antibiotics provide selective pressure. So when you give an organism antibiotics, they have two options. They can adapt or they can die. Okay. When you're given those two options, you can imagine, you know, if you're a bacteria or even as a human, you want to adapt because you want to survive. So some of those organisms will adapt. They can make protein pumps that will take the antibiotic once it's gotten into the cell and pump it back out so it has no effect. They can change the receptors where the antibiotic will bind. So you can have an antibiotic will try to bind to a particular protein, but it can't, so it has no effect. They can make decoy proteins. So some bacteria will put out little proteins that will bind the antibiotic but don't lead anywhere. They don't do anything, so there's no effect. And they can also put out enzymes that will cut up and digest those antibiotics. And in some cases, when they do that, they can actually turn that antibiotic into something they can use to grow, which is like, no, we don't want, as humans, we don't want that, right? So they have decided to adapt. If they adapt, they can pass on their offspring and increase their fitness and increase their presence. But if they can't, they'll die. So that selective pressure is the foundation of antibiotic resistance. And resistance is commonly formed on plasmids and transferred between organisms via plasmids. So like we talked about with conjugation a couple slides ago, but you can also have resistance genes can be present on the actual chromosome itself. So it's not exclusive to plasmids. One illness that you might be familiar with is MRSA, or methicillin resistant staph aureus. And this is a strain of staph aureus that has become resistant to a later stage antibiotic called methicillin. So, and it's commonly used in the hospitals. So let's say you got a strain of, generally this is how it works. Let's say you go to the doctor and you get a you have some sort of issue, and they do a test and they say, oh, you have, I don't know, you have a staph infection. Okay, just keep with this example, and they give you a normal first stage one antibiotic, because generally those will work. And let's say that doesn't work. You take that antibiotic, you take it like you're supposed to, you do the entire regimen, and nothing happens. Then you go back to the doctor, and the doctor's like, okay, this is resistant. So they'll give you another stage of that antibiotic, right? Sometimes when you go to the doctor, if you have really good healthcare, they'll go ahead and check for resistance ahead of time, so you can kind of skip some of these steps, but let's keep with the example. So they'll give you a next stage antibiotic. So, and then let's say that doesn't work, then you have a next stage. Well, for some of these organisms, there are no more stages of antibiotic to give to the patient. And when that happens, you just kind of hope and pray that your immune system can do the job, and that's it. MRSA is one of the most common infections of humans right now. It's becoming more and more common. It did start in hospitals, so kind of like I was just saying, it started with people who were sick in hospitals getting treated, but due to some factors, which we'll talk about in the next slide, they developed resistance and then eventually went into the community. So before, it was mostly getting MRSA from visiting maybe someone in the hospital and not properly hand washing and things like that, you might get MRSA. But nowadays, it can be someone you interact with on a day-to-day basis, or even if you touch something that has the bacteria on it, that can make yourself sick. So MRSA is something that you'll probably hear about more and more as time goes on, because it's becoming more and more resistant to various organisms. We're actually starting, various antibiotics, we're actually starting to see something called VRSA, which is vancomycin resistant staph aureus as well, in the community. So you can see how this is getting crazier and crazier. Eventually, we won't have any antibiotics to combat staph aureus infections, and that will essentially lead us back into a pre-antibiotic era. Scientists have predicted that maybe in the next 50 years, by 2050, well, I guess 30 years, 2050 or so, most of our antibiotics will no longer be effective. So we have to make some changes. And the prevalence of antibiotic resistance is actually due to antibiotic overuse and antibiotic misuse. So most of the antibiotics are actually not used by humans. Most are used in the farming and agriculture industry, but there are, and that causes problems, because now you have a high amount of antibiotic in these organisms, like cow, let's say we have a cow, a high amount of antibiotic used in these cows or chickens. And then that meat has antibiotics in it, and then we're consuming it. So we're getting doses of antibiotics. And some of these doses might be sub-level. And when you have lower levels of antibiotic that aren't quite able to kill the bacteria, but they are present, it'll actually encourage the bacteria to become resistant. And also we have misuse. So let me give you a piece of advice. If you ever go to the doctor and they say you have a virus infection and they give you antibiotics, get a new doctor, okay? Antibiotics do not work on viruses. Antibiotics only work on bacteria. I've actually had several people come to me and say that they had a virus infection and their doctor gave them penicillin or gave them ampicillin or some other antibiotic, and I tell them, go find a new doctor. If you have the flu and they give you antibiotic, that is not proper and you need a new doctor, because this type of misuse actually is very harmful, because like I mentioned before, you're providing that selective pressure, which means that you're putting more possibility of these resistant bacteria to be out there in the environment. They will adapt, and then they'll become more prevalent in humans. And also, when you misuse antibiotics as well, when you're taking them when you don't need them, they actually harm your good bacteria, which can then in turn make you sick if you're exposed to a pathogenic bacteria. So you want to make sure that you're using antibiotics when you need them, but you're also using them properly. Doctor says you need to take this regimen, you need to take one pill every day for 9 days. I know it sucks. We've all had to take antibiotics. They usually don't taste good, and it sucks to take them, but you need to take them for the entire 9 days, even if you're feeling well. It is very crucial to the survival of all of us on this planet that everyone makes sure that they take their antibiotics as they're prescribed. So, now that I've kind of harped about antibiotic resistance and doom and gloom, what do we do now? Okay, how is there a way that we can save ourselves? So as I just mentioned, proper use of antibiotics, taking them when necessary, taking them as prescribed throughout the whole dose. Even if you feel better after dose 2, keep taking it to dose 9. There are reasons why it's prescribed that way. Also using antibiotics less. If you don't need antibiotics, like I talked about, when you have a virus, if you have the flu, you just have to wait it out, or you have to take an antiviral, not an antibiotic, okay? So using them when appropriate, also not using them so much in the agricultural industry. A lot of industries have started to switch to using antibiotics less and less when treating their farm animals, and that's actually beneficial to humans as a whole and life as a whole. And then also, we're doing a lot of research out here. So as I mentioned in my intro, my dissertation work was on discovering new antimicrobial agents. It is not an easy thing to do. It's very, very challenging, but there are people out there who are constantly working to make sure that we have a chance. The couple of things that people are really getting a lot of focus in are phage therapy. So this image here, actually at the bottom, these little guys that look like little robots are actually viruses called bacteriophages, and they will infect a bacteria. And if you have a lytic bacteriophage, after they infect it, they will burst that bacteria open. The great thing about them is bacteriophages are very specific, and they generally do not infect any other species of cell other than their target. So phage therapy has gotten a lot of attention because it's able to target these bacterial cells, and there is some drawbacks to it as well, but it's a very promising new type of therapeutic option. We also have discovery of novel therapeutics. So this image up here is actually vancomycin. This picture here is actually the structure of vancomycin. It's not necessarily a new novel antimicrobial or antibacterial agent, but every day people are studying and trying to find and making new chemical compounds as a way of trying to give us more options for combating bacterial infections. And we also have nanoparticles. People who are, to me, I feel much smarter than I, have developed these things called nanoparticles, and they've been really effective at combating bacteria. So this whole process is a perpetual arms race. As we mentioned before, when we talked about predation, there's the predator, the prey evolves, so the predator evolves, the prey evolves, the predator evolves. That same concept is seen here. We develop new antibiotics, and then the bacteria adapt. And then we develop more, and then they adapt. And then we develop more, and they adapt. And this just keeps going on and on and on and on, okay? So it's a perpetual arms race, but that doesn't mean we should give up. We should keep studying and finding new and effective ways. Otherwise, we're screwed. Welcome everyone to part two. So this section of the presentation will cover archaea, protists, viruses, and prions. So it's a lot going on, but make sure you take good notes and read the chapter. So first we'll talk about archaea. So archaea are visually similar to bacteria. If you were to look at them, you'd say this is a bacteria. But in actuality, they're not even closely related to bacteria. They're actually closer related to eukaryotes than they are to prokaryotes. And this table here that I have is just to show you some of the reasons why archaea are not prokaryotes. They do share some commonalities with bacteria, but they actually share more commonalities with eukarya. There's no need to memorize this table. It's just here to kind of show you why this phylogenetic tree is kind of drawn the way it is. And just as a reminder, looking at this phylogenetic tree, the last common ancestor for bacteria, prokaryotes, bacteria, eukaryotes, and archaea is here, but then the last common ancestor for archaea and eukaryotes is here. So they're actually closer related. They have a more recent common ancestor than they do with bacteria, okay? Just as a quick reminder. And archaea are able to live in both extreme and moderate environments. They can be found in the soil outside. They can be found in ponds. They can be found even in the human gut. But what they're really famous for is their ability to live in extreme environments. So when a archaea is living in a very extreme environment, we call them extremophiles. And when they some categories of them are halophiles, which are organisms that love super salty environments, thermophiles that like high temperature, acidophiles that like very acidic conditions, psychrophiles like cold environments. There are some that love pressure. There's so many out there. You don't need to memorize all of these. Just know that they're all extremophiles. They love extreme conditions. Because of this, they're very challenging to study. Once you remove an extremophile from that environment, they will die. You can no longer study them. And you can imagine it's very, very difficult to replicate some of these environments in the lab. Imagine if you had a psychrophile that loves temperatures below, way well below freezing, like temperatures of the Arctic. You would be very, very hard for you to study that organism because you'd have to be in there in the Arctic and all of your equipment cannot be warm. Nothing can heat up. You have to make sure it's always cold. Like, it would be insane. So we actually don't know very much about these extremophiles because we can't really study most of them in the lab, but we know that they're there and we know that they're pretty cool. One example of an extremophile that has been very important to science and to human health and everything has been Thermus aquaticus. And it's because we get an enzyme called TAC polymerase from this archaea, from this microorganism. And TAC polymerase is used in PCR when looking at genes, amplifying genes and things like that. So they can have some serious benefits as well, even though they sometimes can be challenging to study. So next we'll move on to protists. Protists were discovered as the first, are credited as the first eukaryotic cells that had, they have fossils of protists that have a nucleus and they have organelles. But protists is not a monophyletic group, okay? So there is no one common ancestor, one recent common ancestor for all protist groups. You have to go back really far in order to find a common ancestor. So protists in the past has been considered kind of like the, this is going to be a poor term, but kind of like the garbage can of classifications. If it wasn't a bacteria, wasn't an archaea, wasn't a clear animal or plant cell or fungus cell, people were just like, ah, it's a protist. So this grouping contains a lot of organisms that actually aren't even closely related to one another. You can see in this image here, even if you just looked at this phylogenetic tree, we have our ciliates and we have our slime molds, which are two examples. And to find their closest common ancestor You have to go way back to here. It's not like there's a common answer that ancestor that includes all protists. This common ancestor would actually include plants, animals, and fungi to be monophyletic. So this is kind of like a hodgepodge of individuals. You can have animal-like, plant-like, and fungus-like protists. They're not animals, plants, or fungi, but they behave in similar ways to those groups of organisms. They can be unicellular or multicellular, and some are not even microscopic at all, and we'll talk about that in a second. As mentioned before, we can have a lot of protist diversity, and some can actually show characteristics that are similar to other categories of life, even though they are not related, not closely related. The first can be, we're going to talk about our animal-like protists, and these are characteristic of hunting behavior. So they hunt their prey. They can do this by phagocytosis, and they can do it by kind of sweeping prey towards their mouth. But the key here is they can move. So they use their cilia, which are like, hair-like projections on the outside of the cell, or they can use flagella, which in this image here is their blue, that blue parts of the image, to project, propel themselves forward and or even backward or wherever they need to go in order to catch their prey. An example of this are paramecium. The image here is actually not a paramecium, it's Trichomonas vaginalis. But if you want to see a cool video of a paramecium moving around and feeding, click on that YouTube link below. You can have protists that act fungus-like. So some of these make sheet-like colonies over a surface. So when you imagine fungus in nature, some of them you might imagine as kind of like covering a surface, almost like a blanket type sorts. And some protists have this kind of method of growth as well. Even though they look like a fungus, they might not actually be a fungus. Some of them can reproduce using spores. Some of them have fruiting bodies. All of these characteristics, especially the spores and the fruiting bodies, are common in fungi, but these are protists. Remember, they're not fungi. An example are plasmodial slime molds. Some of you might have seen them in videos. They're really cool to watch grow. If you want to see that, click on that YouTube link below here. And then you can have some that are plant-like. And so plant-like ones, they may even look like plants. These are some of the protists that I mentioned that might be multicellular. They might be huge. Some examples like our seaweed. Seaweed is massive, and you might look at it and think, oh, that's a plant, but it's actually not a plant. It's a protist, and it's photosynthetic like plants though, which makes them plant-like. Some examples, as I mentioned, are seaweed and diatoms. Diatoms to me are pretty cool. Even though we never really see them, they exhibit some really cool shapes and geometric patterns. So if you want to see some of those diatoms, click on that YouTube link below that image. So some protists are pathogenic. They can infect a variety of organisms, not just humans. They can infect other animals and plants as well. Some examples, we have Plasmodium falciparum, which we are probably most familiar with. It is the parasite that causes malaria, and that is actually, if you want to know, that's this image here. So this image. So these pink balls are cells, and these purple bits are actually the parasite. So you can see these are endoparasites. They're living within their host cell and feeding off of the host cell, essentially. So that's an image of malaria. We also have Trypanosoma brucei, which is responsible for the disease of African sleeping sickness. That image is here. So this guy is Trypanosoma brucei, and these are cells. So they kind of hang out in your bloodstream. And some of you might be familiar with African sleeping sickness, but trypanosomes are a huge category of parasites, and they infect everything from plants to koalas to humans. Like they're all over the place, and they're mostly pathogenic. And then we have Giardia intestinalis, or Giardia lamblia. Sorry. And this causes the illness called giardiasis. have a hard time with this one, clearly. But that one's imaged here. To me, they actually look really cool. I would never want to get them, but they do look cool. A lot of people who've had traveler's diarrhea are familiar with this. You can get this from drinking contaminated water. Oh, by the way, you can get obviously malaria or African sleeping sickness. These parasites are transmitted via mosquitoes. Giardia, you can get from drinking contaminated water. So always drink purified water or water that's been chlorinated. Do not go out in the woods and drink that water. Do not drink raw water. I don't care what anybody says. Don't drink it. Okay. And then you can have Phytomonas staphylia, which is this image here. It's also, to me, kind of beautiful looking. Looks very similar to the trypanosome, which is the image above it, because they are very closely related. And this one actually infects coconut plants and palm oil plants and causes them to wilt. So these are all examples of pathogenic protists. Okay, so now we're going to talk about viruses, and I am highly biased. I think viruses are the most interesting form of not life out there. They cannot reproduce, and they cannot undergo metabolism by themselves, so they're not considered to be living, hence why I said they're not life. Going back to the definition of life, as a reminder, living things have two requirements. They have to be able to reproduce, and they have to undergo metabolism. But they have to be able to do this on their own. Viruses cannot do that outside of a host. And viruses are, a single virus is called a virion, and that's what this image is showing you here. A virion is not a cell, so remember to keep those two things separate. Viruses are very simple in structure, which to me enhances my interest in them, because you wonder how can something so simple cause so much damage. But looking at a virus structure, they're going from inside out. They have genetic material, which lies in the middle here. This genetic material, we're going to talk a little bit more about the diversity we can see in that. But they have genetic material that's surrounded by a capsid, which is this blue kind of structure there. And the capsid is just made of proteins and basically just encases the genetic material. Then sometimes inside the capsid, you'll have protein. So in this image here, there's this red ball is actually a protein. This image is actually a cartoon drawing of HIV. So in this case, that protein is reverse transcriptase, but it can be other proteins. You can also have proteins that are present kind of out here in this space between the capsid and the matrix. And generally, those are proteins that help kickstart the replication of the virus once it's within its host. And then you have your matrix proteins, which are on the outside. And this is usually what you see when you look at pictures of the virus, of an unenveloped virus online or something like that. They might have like an icosahedral, like a kind of geometric shape is what you're looking at. Another thing that you could be looking at if it's an enveloped virus is the plasmid membrane. So this outer image here that looks like it has a whole bunch of tulips on it, this is a representation of the plasmid membrane. And it's actually derived from the host. So when the virus leaves the cell, it takes some of the plasmid membrane with it, which essentially you can imagine it heavily contributes to the death of the cell. But the plasma membrane also has embedded within it these proteins that protrude from it, and they actually play a major role in binding to the host and entering the host cell. So there are three basic pieces here: the protein capsid, which is the dark blue there, the genetic material, which is the DNA or RNA, and then some proteins involved. And it may have a lipid membrane, but that's pretty much it. But even though they're that simple, viruses are incredibly diverse. They can show differences in their genome mostly. So they can be DNA viruses or RNA viruses, meaning their genetic material can be DNA or RNA. They can have a single strand of DNA or RNA or a double strand of DNA or RNA. Their genome can be linear or it can be circular. They can have segmented DNA or non-segmented, or RNA, segmented RNA, unsegmented RNA. And what I mean by segmented, I mean instead of their genetic material looking like this, their genetic material is actually split up into pieces. So this would be a non-segmented, a non-segmented genome, but this would be a segmented genome. And we'll talk about one of the most prevalent viruses out there right now in a second that has a segmented segmented genome. And then they also can be enveloped or not enveloped, and that means that they either have a plasma membrane around them or they don't. They can also be lytic or lysogenic, meaning they can infect a host and then burst out. And basically when they burst out, they lyse the cell or kill the cell, rupture the cell. Or they can be lysogenic, which means they go into the host cell and then they just hang out there. And they can hang out there forever if the conditions are favorable. Or they can, some viruses can switch between lysogenic to lytic. So they'll hang out within the genome of the host. And then if conditions change or if the environment's no longer favorable, then they'll burst out. And then they have various structures. Viruses under a microscope can actually be quite beautiful. You can only see them with an electron microscope because they're exceptionally small, like much smaller than bacteria. But when people do get these images of them, they can actually be quite beautiful. So when I mentioned some structural differences between different viruses, I like this image actually best. It can show you don't have to memorize these, but it just to show you the different types of viruses we have out there. To me, one of the most interesting is Ebola, which is on the far right here. Ebola virus, if you looked at it, it looks like a worm, but it's actually not. It's actually a virus, and it's like almost just basically a tube that contains this RNA genome within the center of it. My personal favorite also are bacteriophages. That's what I ultimately want to study as my career. So bacteriophages are really, really interesting as well. Viruses in general, I feel, are interesting. So if you're interested in virology to any extent, definitely recommend taking microbiology, talk about viruses a little bit more, and then also taking the virology class here. It's really, really interesting. So viral replication is kind of broken up into many stages, but to make it very easy, you enter, they hijack your cellular machinery so they can replicate and make proteins, and then they leave. In the case of lytic viruses, or in the case of lysogenic viruses, they do the same things, but instead of leaving, they just stay. So we're just going to go through some basics of this image. You don't need to know all these details, but I just kind of wanted you to walk you through the basic replication of a virus. So we have our viral particle, and this image here is where we start. So our virus will bind to the cell, the host cell, and using these proteins, these external proteins here, it will cue the cell to bring it in. So it basically tricks your cell into saying, hey, bring me in, I'm good, you want me in there. So your cell will engulf through endocytosis, it'll engulf the virus into a vesicle. And so that's how we move to step two here. So the virus is now inside the cell in a vesicle, but it's not able to really do anything yet because it's still within its capsid, within its matrix, right? So it's still like encased in everything. And it's also in this case within a plasma membrane. So it can't do anything, and it's also within a vesicle. So you can imagine it's within different things. So the first step is to get out of that plasma membrane and that capsid and that matrix. So that leads us to step three, where the pH inside of the vesicle will actually change, and the low pH and the enzymes within that vesicle will break down the capsid and the plasma membrane and the matrix, releasing the genetic information, which is here as kind of like these service bars, into the cytoplasm. From there, the genetic information will get into the nucleus in some cases. Some cases it'll remain in the cytoplasm. It just depends on the kind of virus you have. And it will undergo replication. So Like I mentioned, sometimes these viruses have proteins that will help with this process. Sometimes the viruses don't contain proteins that really help with this process, but essentially it'll go into the nucleus or in the cytoplasm, and it'll hijack your own machinery to start replicating its genome. So all those RNA polymerases, ribosomes, and things that are supposed to be making you, and DNA polymerases that are making stuff for you, are now making stuff for you and the virus. And in some cases, just making stuff for the virus, no longer making proteins and compounds for you. So it'll use for replication and also for transcription. So some of these, some of the genes on the viral genome will be translated, and the transcripts will be sent out into the cytoplasm to be made into proteins. And that's what these images here are, proteins that are viral proteins. Also here in this image, it's showing you viral proteins. I don't think it's important for you to know the difference between early and late proteins. Just know that the genome is being transcribed, and those transcripts are being translated to make viral proteins. And then the genome is also being replicated. And then within the cytoplasm, the genome, which is, I'm going to use a different color. The genome, which is here, that's been replicated, will meet up with proteins. So these are proteins that'll be on the plasma membrane. And then also these proteins, these late proteins and these early proteins, they'll all meet together, and they'll start to form a vesicle. So you can see they're all going here. They're all going to start forming a vesicle. And then that vesicle will pinch off and make a new virion. And that's how the process kind of undergoes. This is a general process for a virus that buds off. Some of them don't bud off like this. Some of them like rupture your cells, just burst them. And some of them, like I said, will just stay within your genome, and they won't come out until they have to. But this is a general gist. You start with entry and then hijacking your system so that it can replicate and make proteins, and then it will leave. Viruses are pathogenic. They need a host to survive. They need you. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. They need a host. And so viruses can infect all phyla of life, including plants, animals, bacteria, fungi, you name it, there's a virus that can infect it. There are actually even viruses that infect larger viruses. So they're insane out here. Viruses can have one host, or they can have multiple hosts that are similar, or they can even have multiple hosts that are from different species, or vastly different species. So there's a lot of dynamics when it comes to viral pathogenesis. Some diseases that were really well known that are caused by viruses are HIV/AIDS. Some cold sores is caused by herpes virus, smallpox, some cancers, like many people or in this age range know about HPV. That virus, human papillomavirus, can cause cancer later in life, or not even later in life, in your midlife, if you will. The flu, the common cold, hemorrhagic fevers. Hemorrhagic fevers are things like Ebola and things like that, where your insides start to basically be ruptured and eaten up, and they'll start to have bleeding from your orifices. And you're basically becoming liquefied from the inside out. Pneumonia and rabies. So the image actually here of this woman, she has smallpox. And smallpox, which you may or may not know, produce these pustules on the skin. So like these little pustules on the skin, and they're basically bumps that are filled with pus. And then when that pus interacts with someone else, it transmits to the next person. And a really interesting and kind of sad thing about smallpox is that these pox are not just on the outside of your body. These pox are also on your internal organs as well. So smallpox is what was a major concern and threat to human health in the past. But luckily, smallpox was actually the first disease eradicated from human population ever. So through a large scale vaccination project. So really the only samples of smallpox that exist anymore are in the CDC here in Atlanta and in a laboratory in Russia, and that's it. Then the image below it is actually this sad looking brown stuff on this leaf, like here and here, is actually showing you the viral infections. This is tobacco mosaic virus. It is a virus that infects tobacco plants and causes death of the cells in the tobacco leaf. And some examples of the effects of viruses on humans is that due to just the Spanish flu, so the 1918 flu, 20 to 50 million people died from just that flu alone. And then we have currently 35 million deaths to date from HIV/AIDS. And if you really think about it, HIV/AIDS has not really been in the human population that long. To kill that many people in such a short period of time is incredibly, it's incredible in a negative way, but it's still incredible. The severity of the harmfulness of a disease, of any disease, is called virulence. You can use it for bacteria, this term for bacteria as well, but I'm interested in introducing it here in the viral chapter, viral portion of the chapter. And some interesting things about viruses, when you talked about virulence, is there is a range, right? So you can have people in the population who have a virus that are asymptomatic carriers, which means that they have the virus, they're shedding virus, they just don't know it. They feel normal. They feel like they're not sick. You only know it if you test them. And then you can have people with mild illness. Sometimes you can have people with kind of middle range illness, and then you can have severe illness. And those people who show illness symptoms are termed as symptomatic carriers. So generally it's easier to spot someone with a virus infection if they are showing symptoms. However, asymptomatic carriers do exist depending on what kind of infection you have. Viruses are attributed to a variety of epidemics and pandemics throughout human history. And when we're talking about kind of combating virus infections, one super bad guy are viruses that have an RNA genome. So both RNA and DNA viruses can be exceptionally pathogenic, but RNA viruses are even harder to combat because they undergo rapid mutations in their genome. If you're a DNA virus, the DNA polymerase that makes your genome does proofreading. So as it goes along, if it puts an A where a T should be or a G where a T should be or something, the DNA polymerase will fix it. And so the genome from the parent virus or the initial virus that caused the infection and all the resulting viruses is relatively the same. Mutation does occur, but it's at a much lower rate. However, when you have an RNA virus, its genome is replicated using RNA polymerase. RNA polymerase is not a proofreading, proof-checking polymerase, and it just makes the new copies. So if there's a nucleotide that's wrong, like an A to a G or something, it doesn't get fixed. And so it can end up with rapid mutations. Many of these mutations will result in a non-vital RNA virus particle. So those, if it gets a certain mutation, it won't be able to survive. It won't be able to infect another host. They're just non-viable. There we go. Viable. However, some of these mutations can actually change the virus from being really good at what it does to being really good at what it does. So it can make them more virulent or cause more severe illness when it goes to infect the next cell. Okay, so we're going to talk specifically about two viral infections, viral pathogens that have heavily affected human populations. The first is influenza. Influenza is an RNA virus. And like I mentioned before, because it's an RNA virus, it mutates very, very rapidly. So every time that the genome is replicated, there's a chance that there is a error there. And there's a chance that that error can result in a stronger, better virus than where it came from. And influenza is transmitted through a respiratory route. So through coughs, sneezing, talking too close to people, all of that can transmit flu from one person to another. You can also get the flu from touching what we call fomites, which are things that are not living but have particles on them. So this guy, your phone, major fomite. If you set your phone down and someone uses it, or it gets any sort of like particles from the air, somebody was at a computer before you and they had the flu and they're coughing and now you're breathing it in, that's how you can get it. You can also get the flu from, let's say your phone is sitting at that table, you come back and that person who's coughed on it, now those particles are on your phone. So, and then you touch the phone and put it, then touch your eyes, and that's how you can get the flu, okay? Long story short, wash your hands, don't touch your face. Stay away from people who are sick. So the one big instance of the flu that had a major effect on the human population was the 1918 flu, or also known as the Spanish flu. And it was a major pandemic that's actually not that long ago, if you really think about it, in human history. How did we get the Spanish flu? And it's the same way that we get a lot of flus that actually come into humans, but not all of them, but some of the more virulent flus, this is how we get it. So it's when the flu has jumped species. So we're going to walk through this top image here. So let's say we have a bird. And this bird has a bird flu, right? Because there's flus for various species. So this bird has bird flu. And it's flying around at a farm or whatever, and somehow it contracts, it passes on its version of flu to a pig. Okay, so now it's given its flu to the pig. So you would think normally, well, a bird flu shouldn't affect a pig, but pigs are actually really unique in the way that they can get infected with various forms of flu from different species. And those flus can mix within that species. So let's say you have a farmer who has human flu, and he's farming these pigs, and that same pig that got infected with bird flu gets infected with human flu. Now both of those and some of those cells within that pig get infected with both flus, the bird flu and the human flu. And so that's what this is trying to show. This pink blob here is the pig cell, and then this green here is bird flu, and this blue here is human flu. So if one single pig cell gets infected with both bird flu and human flu, it can then, both those viruses are going to be replicating within the pig cell. And the viruses are RNA viruses, and they're mutating very quickly, and they're not very careful about what gets put into each virion. So what leaves this pig is actually some hybrid of human and bird flu. Okay, so on the outside of that virion, it will have proteins for both human and birds. Bird flu. It can also have on the inside, so this image here is actually really good to show this. Let's say you had human flu and you had pig flu and then you had bird flu. Let's just say as a little bit more complicated example. The outside will express both any of the flu markers from both the birds and the humans and the pigs or whatever have you, but also their genome will contain pieces from all those different organisms as well. So in our image up here, going back to this virus, this viral particle that came from the mixture of bird flu and human flu within a single pig cell will have not only just bird and human receptors on the outside that allow it to infect both human and bird and pig cells, but it'll also have a genome that's a mixture of bird and human flu. So this is really complicated, but essentially we now have a new virus particle that is actually better at making you sick. So this particle here is what caused the 1918 Spanish flu. So this is kind of why influenza is so hard to combat, because one, we have multiple types of flu that sometimes can jump species, and we also have it undergoing lots of mutations that sometimes can make it more and more virulent, and those mutations change often. So this is also why you have to get a flu shot every year, and there's different flu strains within that shot, because one year H1N1 might be common, and H5N7, okay, might be common. But then throughout that whole year to the next year, those viruses have been replicating, they've been mutating. So by the next year, H1N1 and H5N7 might not be popular anymore. It might be H3N5 and H1N1 and H1N3. Like, you never know. So epidemiologists try their best to predict what kinds of flu, what strains of flu will be out there most impacting people in a particular year. But it is very, very difficult to predict, because influenza is really good at being really bad. The flu, we kind of don't think about it as that big of a deal nowadays, but it actually is a major issue for public health. You can have mild disease, which we most time think about. You stay home and you drink some soup and you pray and you take some Tamiflu and you call it a day. But it can also result in death, and especially if you're immunocompromised, if you have a very virulent strain of influenza, it can kill you. So don't sleep on the flu. Okay. The next illness we're going to talk about is HIV. HIV stands for human immunodeficiency virus, and it can over time develop into AIDS, or acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. And AIDS is a result of a secondary infection taking hold and taking advantage of the fact that you have a lower immune system, and some common secondary conditions that result in that cause AIDS are tuberculosis, pneumonia, and tumors. So this image here is actually quite famous. It is of an AIDS patient in the 90s, and he's clearly underweight and has wasted away. This was very common in the early stages of HIV. HIV has not been known in the human population for very long. It really came about it really started coming about in the late 90s. So the 60s, 70s, 80s, and really in the 80s and 90s is when people became more and more aware of it. And it was really a debilitating illness that seemed like it came out of nowhere at that time. HIV is another form of an RNA virus. So as we mentioned before, it mutates rapidly because of this RNA, and it targets your helper T cells. So it targets your immune cells, which is why it makes it very easy for other pathogens to take over, because those T cells usually would clear out the bacteria that will cause tuberculosis or pneumonia. But if the number of your T cells, your T cell count is very, very low, your immune system can't fight back anymore, and those pathogens will take over and can kill you. HIV is a retrovirus, meaning that it has an RNA genome that is then converted to DNA, and single-stranded DNA, and then it uses your DNA polymerase to form the second strand of DNA, and then it incorporates itself into your genome. So once HIV is in you, it's there. It's incorporated in your genome now, and from there, it will continue to make more viruses that will then go on to infect other cells. The protein, the enzyme that is responsible for making our HIV possible, is reverse transcriptase, and that is the enzyme that converts the RNA to DNA, because you cannot incorporate RNA into a double-stranded DNA host genome. The RNA has to be converted to DNA, and then that DNA has to be made into two strands in order to incorporate itself into your genome. HIV is transmitted through body fluids. This can be through unprotected sex from semen and vaginal fluids. It can be through blood transfusions, using contaminated or dirty needles, which was common in like the 80s and 90s, intravenous drug users it was far more common prior to the clean needle programs that a lot of states have implemented. It can also be transmitted from mother to child. This can be via delivery, pregnancy, and even breastfeeding. So you can imagine in all of these processes, there are a lot of body fluids that are involved, especially during delivery and pregnancy, where those infected body fluids can be transmitted to your child via the eyes, the mouth, and cuts and abrasions and things like that. So, and then breastfeeding, the contaminated breast milk as well. HIV is not transmitted via some other body fluids such as saliva, tears, or sweat. So you don't have to worry about kissing anybody. You're not gonna get HIV from that, but definitely don't share needles or swap blood like the old school ways people. I wouldn't do this anyway, even if it wasn't HIV, but don't, like, you know, the old school movies where they cut people's hand and they cut the other part of their hand and then they put their hands together. That sounds like a bad idea. Never do that, no matter what. But yes, in this case, it would be harmful. So when people first contract HIV, they will get flu-like symptoms. You may think that you just have the flu, call it a day, and then you become asymptomatic. So and that's when the virus has incorporated itself into your T cells genome, and it's just hanging out there. It's still replicating, but it's not, your immune system's not reacting to it the way it was before. So that's why you feel okay, but you're not okay. And then over time, without proper drugs, this can develop into AIDS. And luckily, in such a relatively short period of time, there have been lots of advances in HIV treatment. So we have, I know people have probably seen the commercials online for PrEP. PrEP is not a treatment, it's a preventative agent for those who might be at high risk. But you also have a lot of antiretrovirals that HIV patients can have and use. And it went from, in the 80s, if you had HIV or AIDS, it was a death sentence, to now you can live out your entire life healthfully like a normal person. But the only caveat is you must take your antivirals all the time, every day as prescribed. So this image above is actually a man portioning out his antivirals because he's HIV positive. So you have to make sure you take them, because if you stop taking the drugs or you don't take them as prescribed, you'll actually potentially make your illness worse, because the virus will mutate. It will not be kept under control, and you can actually get a more resistant strain of HIV, and there may or may not be a treatment for that particular strain you have. Even when you do take your antivirals regularly, scientists are still in a battle versus HIV, kind of like what I was talking about, the arms race between humans and discovering antimicrobials, antibacterials, and bacteria. It's the same thing for viruses. We have discovered many, many different antiviral drugs for HIV, but HIV keeps adapting and mutating. And so every person gets a different strain of HIV. So if you get one strain of HIV that may or may not be susceptible to drug A, another person might get a different strain of HIV that is resistant to drug A, right? So these cocktails of drugs, which is what it's called when you have multiple drugs that you have to take at the same time, these are very, very important to the survival of HIV patients. Luckily, a lot of the stigma and negative impacts of HIV have gone away. However, it is important to remain mindful that HIV still kills millions of people around the world each year. So, you know, this is still a huge problem. There is no cure. You can just treat it. Once you have HIV, you have it for life. So always keep that in mind. Last but not least, we have our prions. So prions are even more simple than viruses. They are also not living, and essentially they are just misfolded proteins that go around misfolding other proteins. So this image down here at the bottom, we have a ribbon structure of a protein. And you can see that this part of the protein is an alpha helix. If you don't know what that is, that's fine. Just remember, it looks like a spiral, right? This is properly folded. There's also a helix here. Properly folded protein in the brain functions like it's supposed to. But if it's a prion, you can see that this area here is no longer an alpha helix. It's actually been converted to beta sheets. And that kind of alpha helix that was here is no longer present. So this protein is misfolded. And when this misfolded protein interacts with a properly folded protein, it turns that properly folded protein into a misfolded protein, which then goes on to misfold other proteins and other proteins. So you can see how this is pathogenic. You wouldn't even think that a protein could be pathogenic, but this protein, this misfolded protein, has then recruited other proteins to misfold. This results in a disease called spongiform encephalitis, and that essentially means that your brain develops holes and becomes like a sponge. Some common diseases that are a result of this are Kuru and Creutzfeldt-Jakob's disease and mad cow disease. If you're around my age, you might remember there was a huge mad cow disease scare in the early 2000s, and this is what was happening. So in this image, we have our normal brain cell, our normal brain tissue. This brain tissue is pink all around. It looks healthy and good. But then if you look at the case of Kuru and in scabies and in Creutzfeldt-Jakob's disease, you can start to see these holes. Let me try to pick another color. You can see these holes that have developed in this brain tissue. That is spongiform encephalitis, and this can result in dementia, memory loss, loss of balance and coordination, and it is lethal. So it eventually results in death. There is no cure for prion diseases. Many people have really put a lot of work and effort into studying these diseases, and we're making some good progress, but at this point there is no cure for prion diseases. Alrighty, with that said, you've made it to the end. Woo! Diversity of microbes. So I'll go ahead and definitely read chapter 15. If you haven't started reading chapter 15 after the first half, definitely start reading it now. The entire chapter 15.1 through 15.19. Also do the learning curve assignment, and we'll have a COVID-19 group assignment that will be posted on iCollege as well for you guys to complete. And I hope you're as interested in microbes as I am now. And I hope to have inspired some future microbiologists out there. Alrighty, have a good one.